IC number 26 is Hot and New Trends in Retina, and the chief instructor is Dr. Divya Balakrishnan.
Good afternoon. Welcome all to the session of Hot and New in Retina. At the outset, I would like to thank Chairman Scientific Committee and KSOS for giving us this opportunity. The session is to discuss and familiarize everyone with what is happening new in the field of medical retina. Now, let me welcome our first speaker, Dr. Divya Alex, who is a young, dynamic researcher and academician and an excellent surgeon from Giridhar Eye Institute. She'll be delivering a talk on newer terminologies in spectral domain OCT. Welcome, Divya Alex.
Greetings to Amanda. I would like to thank Dr. Divya Balakrishnan and KSOS for giving me this wonderful opportunity. I'm Dr. Divya Alex, working as a VR consultant at Giridhar Eye Institute. For the next few minutes, I'll be sharing a talk on newer terminologies in OCT. The retina practice has changed in such a way that the diagnosis is incomplete without an OCT image. We all know that. Discovered in 1991, over the last 20 years, the OCT has seen smaller and higher resolution delivery devices. From the time domain OCT era, where everything was more of a conjunctor or a type of guessing, the OCT has evolved into spectral domain and then into Stepson's OCT, where even the choroidal imaging is crystal clear. From 400 A scan per second to 4 lakh A scan per second, the axial resolution have increased to 5 micron so that every retinal layer is visible, so that the number of emerging terminologies is increasing day by day. In 2014, at International Nomenclature OCT panel, Storenghi et al. Proposed a nomenclature system for the normal anatomic landmarks in SDOCT. The external limiting membrane, it comprises of the junctional complexes between the Müller cell and the inner segment of photoreceptors. Beneath that is the myoid zone or the hyporeflective region. It corresponds to the innermost segment of the photoreceptors. And again, below that is the ellipsoid zone, which was previously known as the ISOS junction. It comprises of the inner and the outer segment photoreceptor junction. They are highly reflective because they are highly packed with mitochondria, and the myoid zone is relatively hyperreflective because of the lower density of the mitochondria. And then come the interdigitation zone. It consists of the epices of the RP cells that encases the cone outer segment. This was previously referred to as the cone outer segment tip or the cost. Then comes the choroid. It contains the choriocapillary and the middle satellar layer and the huge vessels in the hollows layer. In Greek, lepto means thin and pachy means thick. So the leptochoroid is a new clinical entity characterized by geographical hyperpigmented fundus centered in the macula, surrounding relatively hypopigmented fundus, and which is associated with decreased choroidal thinning. This is not related to myopia alone. So this is a normal choroid, this is an extremely thin choroid, and this is a pachy or the thick choroid. Pachychoroid is characterized by focal or diffuse choroidal thickening, attenuation of the choriocapillaries overlying the underlying dilated choroidal vessels in the hollows layer, which is also known as pachy vessel, and which is associated with progressive retinal pigment epithelial dysfunction and neovascularization later on. So the thick choroid comes in pachychoroid spectrum. It contains a lot of diseases like CSCR, pachychoroid pigment epitheliopathy, pachychoroid neovasculopathy, the PCV, focal choroidal excavation, and peripapillary pachychoroid syndrome. PPE, or the pachychoroid pigment epitheliopathy, was introduced by Varroa et al. It is characterized by mottling of the RPE, irregular radius of RPE elevation, which is termed as Prusnoid RPE lesion. PPE is usually asymptomatic and found in the fellow eyes of CSCR. The RPE elevation with microbreak can be a pre-runner to the formation of subretinal fluid formation, can be considered as a form frustae of CSCR. It was subsequently observed that the patients with PPE could go on to develop type 1 neovascularization even without the development of CSCR. Pachychoroid neovasculopathy, it is also known as PCN or PNV. It was Pang and Freud who described this condition. And this is a type 1 neovascularization which appears on a pachychoroid spectrum. So this appears on an OCT as a double layer sign. And with the advent of Octa, The diagnosis of PCN is more straightforward. The octa reveals a tangled filamentous branching vascular network with a flow signal corresponding to the RR sign. The sensitivity of the octa in detecting BVN, it is definitely more than that of ICG. So the double layer sign was first described by Sato et al. And double layer sign can be defined as a separation of the RPE from the underlying Bruch's membrane with hyperreflective material in between. And this hyperreflective material, it is considered to be the encroaching type 1 neovascularization. So if it is hyperreflective DLS, it is considered to be a part of PCV or PCN. And if it is a hyperreflective DLS, that is only separation without hyperreflectivity in between, it could be a part of CSCR. Peripapillary pachychoroid syndrome, or the PPS, is a distinct variety of the pachychoroid disease spectrum in which maximal choroidal thickness occurs close to the optic nerve rather than that of subfoveal. These patients typically present with nasal, macular, intraretinal fluid, or a Schiess-like picture, or subretinal fluid with a crowded disc and occasionally optic nerve head edema. The peripapillary choroidal congestion with a compartment-like effect on the peripapillary region is considered to be as an etiology. It is important to recognize this clinical entity, which can be confused with posterior uveitis or neuro-ophthalmic disorders. The maximal choroidal thickness occurring close to the optic nerve helps in differentiating. Focal choroidal excavation can be described as a concavity in the choroid occurring without any adjacent scleral abnormality and normal appearing overlying retina. It can be congenital or it can be acquired. The FCA lesion could represent scarring of a choroidal connective tissue from a previous inflammatory process. Presumably, a scar contraction could draw the choroid and RP towards the sclera producing an FCA. Two patterns have been described. Conforming and a non-conforming. In conforming FCE, the photoreceptor tips are in direct contact with the RPE, whereas in non-conforming, the photoreceptor tips appear to be detached from the underlying RPE and there is a hyporeflective cleft in between the space. So this non-conforming FCE can be misdiagnosed as subretinal fluid. Coined by Speight, pachydrusen is a relatively new entity. And this is characterized by the soft drusen in a thick choroid. It usually occurs in young. And reticular pseudodrusen or the subretinal drusenoid deposit. This occurs in usually older people and within a thin or normal choroid. Pachydrusen occurs in a thick choroid. So you can see in the soft drusen, which occurs under the RPE, whereas the reticular pseudodrusen, they are subretinal. They occur above the RPE. The pachydrusen is a relatively new entity. It is characterized by isolated or scattered yellowish white deposit, the larger one exceeding more than 125 microns. They have a better defined outer border and they are usually distributed on the posterior fold, sparing the macula, and they can be seen in the peripapillary region and near the arches. Whereas the reticular pseudodrusen are net-like, numerous, distributed all over the posterior fold in a yellowish interlacing pattern. They are best seen in IR image as hyporeflectance, and this reticular pseudodrusen increases the risk of developing advanced AMD as well as it is considered as a precursor lesion for the type 3 or the RAP. Subretinal hyperreflective material, it is defined as hyperreflective material located between the neurosensory retina and the RPE. The range of shrunk seen in macular diseases can be neovascular tissue, fibrin, exudates, vitelliform material, and hemorrhage. So it can be vascular or avascular. The opta or the OCT angiography reveal can distinguish vascular from the avascular shrunk. And if it is vascular, it shows an entangled network with a strong intrinsic flow signal. Shrunk can be considered as a surrogate OCT biomarker in predicting final visual outcome. So the foveal involving shrunk, the well-defined shrunk borders, the thicker shrunk, and persistence of shrunk even after anti-VEGF therapy, they are considered to be poor OCT biomarkers. Coming to Crora and Aurora, the classification of atrophy meeting CAMP recently proposed a consensus definition nomenclature or HDOCT defined geographical atrophy in the setting of AMD. Crora means complete retinal pigment epithelium and outer retinal atrophy, and Aurora means incomplete RPE and outer retinal atrophy. So there is evidence of overlying photoreceptor degeneration and the attenuation of the loss of RP. So whenever there is a photoreceptor or RP attenuation, there will be choroidal hypertransmission, which is seen in the society. So if this criteria is at least there for 250 micron diameter, it is called as crora, or the complete retinal and the outer retinal atrophy. And if does not fulfill all the three criteria, and if there is a discontinuous hypertransmission, which is seen in this, it is called as irora, or the incomplete RPE and the outer retinal atrophy. There are two other terminologies as iora and fiora. That means incomplete outer retinal atrophy and complete outer retinal atrophy. In these cases, the retinal pigment epithelium will be intact, whereas the outer retinal, the ellipsoid zone, will be lost. So in this condition, you can see a case starting from irora to complete retinal pigment epithelium and outer retinal atrophy. The drill can be defined as a lack of distinguishable boundaries between the ganglion cell inner plexiform layer complex, inner nuclear layer, and the outer plexiform layer in the central 1 millimeter. This was defined by Sun et al. So in this picture, you can clearly distinguish each and every inner retinal layer. But in the case of drill, it is unable to distinguish the inner retinal layer. The difference between these two pictures can be noted. So the development of drill is not specific to DME. It is a common response to retinal stress. It is a negative predictive OCT biomarker. For each 100 micron increase in drill, there is a negative impact of approximately 6 letters. And it has been found that DEX implant has the potential to ameliorate drill, and it is related to the architectural effect on the molar cell. Coming to AFL, or the ectopic inner foveal layers, it is a sign of ERM progression. So in the stage 1 ERM, there is a normal foveal architecture with the ERM. And in the stage 2, the foveal contour is lost. But in the stage 3, you can see the chronic anteroposterior and centripetal traction caused by this ERM. It induces the displacement and reorganization of the inner retinal layers, creating a continuous flow of inner retinal tissue extending from the INL and the plexiform layer across the central fovea. This is called as EFL, or the ectopic inner foveal layer, which can be clearly seen in stage 3 ERM. So the thickness of the EFL has a negative correlation with the visual outcome. So explaining all this in the rapid phase of advancement, I believe this talk helped you to move a further step forward. So thank you for the patient listening. I'll be stop sharing.
Thank you, Divya, for that wonderful talk. Now, let me welcome our next speaker, Dr. Rahul Menon. He is a VR consultant from Chaitanya Eye Hospital, Cochin. He will be talking about newer diseases in retina.
Hello, everyone. At the outset, I would like to thank the KSO's scientific committee and Dr. Divya for giving me this chance. So I'll be talking about the newer diseases in retina. I'll be discussing about PVAC, PAM, HORV, and non-exudative CNVM. So the first one is PVAC, or Perifoveal Exudative Vascular Anomalous Complex. This was first described by Quercus and group. So PVAC can affect healthy individuals and can coexist with other macular diseases like AMD and myopic maculopathy. Clinically, it is seen as a unilateral large isolated perifoveal aneurysms, which can be also be arranged in groups. It is usually associated with hemorrhages and exudation. There should not be any signs of inflammation or vascular occlusion. So the multicolor image of this patient with PVAC shows exudates and hemorrhages in the perifoveal area. FFA shows a well-defined lesion in the early phase, which leaks in the late frame. ICGA shows a well-defined hypofluorescent lesion in the early frame, but there is no leakage in the late frame. OCT shows a rounded lesion with the hyperreflective wall, intraretinal cystic spaces, and hard exudates. OCTA demonstrates detectable flow in the superficial capillary plexus with minimal rarefaction of the vessels, but there is no flow in the deep capillary plexus in the area of the lesion. So what are the differentials of PVAC? Group 1B macrotelangiectasia, where both the superficial and deep capillary plexus is affected. But a very important difference here is that it typically responds to anti-VEGF treatment, Diabetic macular edema is another differential. Now, the important difference here is that PVAC is usually unilateral and the FFA leakage is only limited to the area of lesion, while the surrounding region is usually normal. Now, the management, masterly inactivity seems to be the only option with us now, because anti-VEGF are usually ineffective because of the endothelial cell injury that accompanies PVAC. But do keep a close watch on these patients, as there are reports of some of them developing a type 3 CNVM later on. Next, I'll be discussing about paracentral acute middle maculopathy, in short, PAM. So this was first described by David Seraf and group. Technically, it is an SGOCT finding in which the middle retina is affected. Previously, there existed confusion whether PAM is a type or a subset of AMN or acute middle maculopathy. But the very authors who described have very clearly stated that PAM is entirely different from AMN. Even though PAM and AMN share a common ischemic microvascular origin, there are few differences between them, such as the AMN is seen in younger individuals, it is very rare, while PAM is much more common if you take into consideration both primary and secondary PAM. So primary PAM is usually when it is idiopathic, while secondary when it's associated with other vascular diseases. On OCT, PAM affects above the OPL, while in AMN, the lesion is below the OPL. And usually, the ellipsoid and ELM layer are unaffected in PAM. So even though it is an OCT diagnosis, clinically, it appears very much like a cotton wool spot in the juxtafoveal region. Now, in contrast to the cotton wool spot, the PAM lesion clinically appears deeper within the retina, smoother in consistency, and grayer than a cotton wool spot. Near infrared reflectance image, OCT, and OCTA are the diagnosis investigations of choice. So the NIR image reveals a corresponding hyporeflective, well-demarcated lesion in case of acute PAM. SGOCT demonstrates a placoid hyperreflective band at the level of INL, sparing the outer retina. Whereas, in case of chronic PAM, the NIR image is usually normal. And mind you, the OCT image on the left is not fovea, but showing a focal thinning of the IPL, INL, and the OPL in chronic PAM, while the ONL lesion area appears slightly thickened. OCT of the foveal section of the same patient is shown in the right, which appears absolutely normal. In OCTA, we can see a flow void area in the deep capillary plexus. Now, it may herald the presence of a secondary underlying condition, warranting an appropriate systemic workup. Full resolution of scotoma have been reported, but partial resolution is a common outcome. Significant visual impairment is uncommon. Also, a word of caution, PAM has been recently reported in cases of COVID-19 affected individuals. Next is HORV, or hemorrhagic occlusive retinal vasculitis. Many have advocated the use of intraoperative intracameral antibiotics during cataract surgery. So it tends to occur in patients post-cataract surgery where vancomycin has been used. Initially, these patients have good post-operative visual acuity and tend to present between 1 to 14 days after surgery with painless vision loss. On anterior segment, there is a mild AC reaction. Fundus shows diffuse venular sheathing, white centered retinal hemorrhages, and macular edema. FFA, you will see diffuse and early staining with late leakage and blockage in areas of hemorrhage. OCT shows submacular detachment and hyperreflective inner layer suggestive of ischemia. They carry a very poor prognosis. Because of the rapid development of NVI and neovascular glaucoma, treatment includes anti-VEGF and early PRP. Now, choroidal neovascularization is a hallmark or feature of neovascular AMD, because the pathologic angiogenesis from the choroid results in exudation, hemorrhage, and fibrosis, resulting vision loss. So, non-exudative CNVM is, the term itself is self-explanatory. The gold standard for CNV diagnosis has been fluorescein angiography. Since the CNVM endothelium is incompetent, there's a leak of FFA, fluorescein molecules, and the CNVM is diagnosed. Therefore, by definition, CNV detected with FA is exudative. So, wouldn't it be better to have a test that can identify the CNVM before the development of exudation? So in 2013, Quercus and group described treatment naive quiescent CNVM based on multimodal imaging, including FFA, ICG, and OCTA. They have called it quiescent CNV and was defined as angiographically both FA and ICG detected CNVM, which showed an absence of intraretinal or subretinal excitation on repeated OCT during follow-up, which were done at least 6 months apart. Now, different authors have coined it different terms such as subclinical macular neovascularization, quiescent CNV, and non-excitative CNVM. With the advent of OCTA imaging, it has been detected much more commonly. So, De Oliveira and group found the incidence of non-excitative CNVM in the fellow eyes of excitative CNVM patients to be 14.4%, of which 21.1% progressed to excitation over a period of 6 months. Yanagi and group found the incidence to be 19% and the progression rate to excitation was 22.2%. Bailey and group found the incidence to be around 8%, but they found that there was an 18-fold chance of excitation developing in this eyes. So, do we always need an OCTA to diagnose non-excitative CNVM? No. The composite image of a multicolor image can also detect non-excitative CNVM in many of these cases, where it is seen as a network of bright orange color. Now, the only option that we have is to keep a close watch, as prophylactic anti-VEGF therapy may be counterproductive and hasten the geographical atrophy, and also it would be very difficult to attain a clinical endpoint in the management of such cases. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Rahul, for that wonderful talk. The next talk is imaging, what is new? I'll be delivering the talk. I'm Dr. Divya, a senior vitreoretinal consultant from Giridhara Institute.
At the outset, I would like to thank ASRS for giving me this opportunity. I'll be talking about retinal imaging, what is new. The topic will be discussed under the following subheadings. Imaging techniques have evolved with time, and confocal scanning laser ophthalmoscope is one of the techniques which is being widely used in the recent imaging systems. It uses laser light instead of white light to illuminate the retina. Point by point scanning of the entire field by a focused laser beam capture the reflected light through a small confocal pinhole. Multicolor imaging is one of the options which is available with the Spectralis. It uses three different laser beams to create a pseudo color image of the fundus. This is one of the example of the multicolor image. The left lower shows IR reflectance image, which shows deeper structures in the choroid and the RPE. The green reflectance image is useful for examining blood vessels and exudates. The blue reflectance image is best for spotting changes in the superficial retinal structures like epiretinal membrane. This is a case of PCV. The fundus photograph shows polypoidal orange lesion. The white arrow in the multicolor image shows an ill-defined area, which corresponds to a hyperautofluorescence in the fundus autofluorescence. Corresponding structural OCT B-scan shows subretinal fluid. The yellow arrow shows well-defined area outside the ill-defined area in the multicolor image, which corresponds to a well-defined area of hyperautofluorescence in FAF. This corresponds to an area of outer photoreceptor loss in the structural OCT B-scan. Fundus angiogram and ICG shows a vascular network with a polypoidal lesion, but it failed to pick up the other changes which were seen in multicolor imaging and fundus autofluorescence. PDR fundus of the right eye in the conventional photograph shows neovascularization over the disc, which is better delineated in the multicolor imaging, and you can see the hard exudates and the neovascularization. This is a fundus picture of a conventional fundus photograph taken through a cataractous lens and through a multicolor imaging. You can see the details are better delineated in the multicolor imaging. The details of changes because of the moderate NPDR, like cotton wool patches, are better delineated in multicolor imaging. And again, the PDR neovascularization changes are seen better in the multicolor imaging. This is a multicolor imaging of the OCT. The lower frame shows the 3D OCT slab and the OCT section. So multicolor imaging is useful in various conditions like reticular pseudotracheal, geographic atrophy, vascular changes, retinal dystrophies, and PCV. The major limitations being the longer fixation time to acquire three images and artifact like ghost maculopathy, which is clearly seen in this image, where you can see a whitish dot which is seen in the multicolor image and all the reflected images, but it is not seen in the fundus autofluorescence. The other imaging modality is the ultra wide field imaging. It captures a single capture image at the fovea, with fovea at the center and the retina anterior to the vortex ampulla in all the four quadrants. It's achieved by using again the confocal scanning laser of thermoscopic technique. The available systems are Optos, Heidelberg Spectralis, Claris, Storenkey, and Redcam images. Coming to the Optos wide field system, it's again based on the SLO technique, and it uses two different wavelengths to recreate a composite pseudo color image of the posterior segment along with the use of a large ellipsoid mirror. It can capture a 200 degree field of view in an undilated pupil. So this is an pseudo color image and the corresponding fundus wide field fundus autofluorescence of a multifocal Best disease. The left image shows a peripheral avascular retina. This is ultra wide field angiograph, which is taken by the Optos. The right image shows peripheral CNP areas with telangiectatic dilatation, suggestive of a Coats disease. The right image shows a wide field angiograph of a case of a laser PDR, which shows a persistent neovascularization in the fundus, which is easily picked up by the wide field angiograph. So wide field imaging is useful in vascular diseases like diabetic retinopathy, vascular occlusion, pediatric retinal disorders, and in documenting peripheral retinal degeneration. But the limitation being artifacts due to lashes, pseudo color, and peripheral image distortion. The other imaging modality using the wide field imaging is Mirantia by Nidak, which is a newer one. Again, it is based on the SLO technique. It has high definition OCT and confocal SLO, and it can also acquire wide field images. So it uses four different laser wavelengths to recreate the image and to a near normal fundus image. It can also obtain octa fundus photography, FA, ICG, green and blue fundus autofluorescence, and retromodes. With an optional wide field lens, it can procure at about 163 degrees of the fundus, and the longest OCT can be measured of 16.5 mm in this machine. This is an example of a multimodal imaging by Mirante. The OCT B-scan shows a hyperreflective material under the RPE and cuticular drusen. The green autofluorescence shows hyperautofluorescence at the center. The blue autofluorescence is reduced at the center because of the blockage by the macular pigments. Confocal image shows a multiple cuticular drusen. The retro mode is one of the options which is available in this, which shows extensive involvement at the posterior pole. The retro mode is being obtained by blocking the direct light and procuring more of the background illumination, which is similar to that of the retro illumination in the anterior segment. Most of the wide field images use a different wavelength and so procure a produce a pseudo color image, while the DRS plus fundus camera by center view actually uses a white LED to get a near normal color fundus. It can be used in small pupil and it is fully automatic. It can be used as one of the tele screening tools for diabetic retinopathy. The other advancement is a wide field octa. One of the major disadvantages of octa was the limited field which can be used for imaging. With the wide field imaging, this is a which is procured by using a size plexelite 9000 strepsiform OCT angiograph. The left image shows the extended field imaging obtained by SSOCT. The white circle is the area which is being covered by actually a spectralis wide field FA angiograph. The central square depicts the area which is being imaged by SSOCT without an EFI. The last image shows the VR interface segmentation wherein you can see the neovascularization. This is an example of a wide field octa, which is again obtained by a Zeiss Plex Elite 9000 SSOC octa. The fundus shows a superior hemi-retinal vein occlusion with the neovascularization. The CNP areas and the neovascularization is clearly seen in the wide field octa. One of the limitations is highlighted in this image. The white arrow shows areas of a capillary non-perfusion or a phlovoid area in SSOCT and extended field imaging octa. But the wide field angiogram shows the fully perfused area corresponding to that phlovoid area in the octa. This is because of the low flow in that area, which is detected as a CNP area. The other imaging modality is the OCT NFOS imaging, which uses a dense raster scan to acquire an image cube of the posterior pole. A software is used to reconstruct the C-scan images on the coronal plane. So this is usually the OCT, structural OCT B-scan actually procures the axial scans, but by this NFOS image, you can get the coronal plane scans. So this is an example of a scan of the coronal scan through the superficial capillary plexus area. The second one is through the deep capillary plexus area. And the third one is through the outer retinal area, which shows the nicely the edges of the capillary, edges of the choroidal neovascular membrane. The advantage of the OCT UNFOS image could make screening of the entire scanned retinal area more efficient. Versus the conventional cross-section scans, which can miss the small lesions lying between the individual B-scans. And its ability to precisely localize lesion within the specific subretinal layers using their axial location on the OCT cross-sections. And also to register the projected images to other fundus imaging modality using the retinal vessels as the landmark. This is an example of OCT NFOS image of a Mutes case. The fundus picture shows very subtle changes, and the fundus fluorescein angiogram shows a few areas of hyperfluorescence. ICG shows multiple areas of hypofluorescence. The OCT structural image shows loss at the ISOS junction. The on-pulse image through the ISOS ellipsoid zone shows multiple areas, which is shown in the initial presentation, which is reduced in the follow-up OCT scan. The other newer imaging modality is the adaptive optics, which is a discipline to improve the performance of an optical system by reducing the effect of wavefront distortion. It was adopted from the AO telescopes, where it was used to adjust the atmospheric turbulence. Here in the eye, it is used to reduce the wavefront aberrations. It uses the Hartmann-Shack wavefront sensor and the deformable mirror with the better axial and transverse resolution. It can allow the detailed evaluation of photoreceptors and vasculature. So this picture depicts how clearly the details at the cellular level can be imaged by using an adaptive optics with the resolution of 2 micrometer. So what are the equipments with the AO? AO flood illumination ophthalmoscopy, which can observe structures like capillaries and the outer segment of cone. The limitation being the low axial resolution of 300 microns. AO OCT shows higher resolution, both transverse and axially, and it can enable the 3D cellular imaging. But it is inability to detect fluorescent signals, which restrict the imaging of the retinal structures. The slow speed of the 3D imaging, which may reduce the imaging quality with eye movement. AO SLO, on the other hand, has an axial resolution lower than an AO OCT, but it can detect fluorescent signals, which enable the imaging methods like AO SLO, FA, ICG, or FAF. And high-speed recording of the high-speed recording speed of the single frame will help to reduce the artifacts. So this is an example of a AOSLO montage. The A image is an AOSLO montage, and the B is the corresponding fundus fluorescein angiogram. B is the image magnified view of the rectangle of the fundus fluorescein image, and D, F is the enlarged image corresponding to the rectangle in the AOSLO montage. And the C is the detailed enlargement at enlarged area at the corresponding to the area of the square in the F image, which shows the details at a cellular level. So the advances in imaging helps in multimodal imaging with better resolution and wide field imaging and using non-mitriatic cases and faster acquisition. It also helps to understand the pathology better, guide treatment and follow up in research. Thank you.
Now let me welcome Dr. Dilish. He is a VR surgeon who is currently working at Almaz Hospital Cortical. He'll be talking about newer drugs in retina.
Greetings, everyone. I'm Dr. Dilish P. Chandrasekaran. I work as a VR surgeon at Almaz Hospital, Kottakkal. I would like to thank the Kerala Society of Ophthalmic Surgeons for giving me this wonderful opportunity, and also Dr. Divya, our chief instructor. Over the next few minutes, I would like to give you a short synopsis of the newer drugs in retina, some of which have already been released and some of which are in the pipeline at different stages of research. I have omitted the gene therapy, which will be covered in greater detail in our keynote address. It is a vast topic to be finished in 8 minutes. Since the first anti-VEGF ranibizumab was approved for intraocular use of wet AMD in 2006, there have been several other drugs which have come about, and these have vastly improved visual outcomes in wet AMD and other diseases and saved millions from visual impairment throughout the world. So we'll be discussing these drugs under three main headings. First of all, the drugs for wet AMD, which will also be used for DME and retinal vein occlusions, and we'll discuss newer routes of drug administration, and then thirdly, drugs for dry age-related macular degeneration. So there are certain lacunes in the treatment of wet AMD at present. First of all, we have need frequent injections and follow-up. So to address this, we need longer-acting drugs and drug delivery systems which enable longer action of the same drugs. And there is a poor response in a subset of patients. So to tackle this, we need more efficacious drugs which block other pathways and other VEGF isoforms. And because intravitreal injections is invasive, we also have a felt need for oral and topical medications which can achieve similar results. So coming to drugs in wet AMD as such, first of all, we have the newer anti-VEGF. First is the new kid on the block, your brolucizumab. So how is it different from other anti-VEGF? It is a smaller molecule of 26 kilodaltons, and this will enable it to deliver a higher molar dose within a single injection. So it is manufactured by Novartis. So in the Hawk and Harrier study, it was found to be non-inferior to aflibercept in wet AMD. It was also found that it has a better potential of reducing retinal fluid compared to aflibercept. The small side effect which was found was intraocular inflammation was little on the higher side. Another drug which is being looked at is your KSI-301, manufactured by Kodiak Sciences. It is a full-length antibody against VEGF-A linked to a biopolymer, delivering a large 950 kilodalton molecule, which stays in the eye and it's therefore longer acting. It is also an intravitreal drug, and in the phase 1 trial, it was found that 55% of the eyes remained treatment-free for a period of 6 months or longer, and 84% remained treatment-free for around 4 months after 3 loading doses. Dazzle phase 2 trial of the same drug is going on as of now, comparing it to the aflibercept. Another drug is abicipaprigol, manufactured by Allergan. It is not a monoclonal antibody, but rather it is using the DARPin technology or ankyrin repeat proteins. And the resultant molecule has a high binding affinity to VEGF. And in CEDAR and SEQUOIA trial, it was found that abicipar 8 weekly and 12 weekly delivered visual outcomes similar to ranibizumab 4 weekly regimen. It also had a higher inflammation rate, probably related to the use of E. coli in manufacture of these ankyrin proteins. Another anti-VEGF is a Conbercept from Chengdu Pharmaceuticals in China. In Phoenix trial phase 3, it was compared to a sham injection, and following this, it was approved for use in China. Panda 1 trial as of now is comparing it with aflibercept. Then coming to other mechanisms of action, you have the faricimab, which is an antibody, bispecific antibody against anti-VEGF and against VEGF-A and angiopoietin 2. In the Stairway phase 2 trial, it was found that faricimab 12 weekly and 16 weekly regimens were comparable to ranibizumab 4 weekly regimen in terms of visual outcome. So when VEGF-A is inhibited, there's a possibility that other isoforms may be upregulated, which can also act on your VEGF receptor 2 and cause the same pathological actions that anti-VEGFs are trying to inhibit. So this research led to the development of this OPT-302 molecule by Opthia Pharmaceuticals, which is a trap inhibitor of VEGF-C and VEGF-D isoforms. So phase 2 trials in combination with ranibizumab of this drug showed better results compared to ranibizumab monotherapy. Another interesting group is your tyrosine kinase inhibitor. So the VEGF receptor 2 intracellular domain has tyrosine kinase activity, and it is at this level that this drug acts. First is your GB102 by Greyberg Pharmaceuticals. It targets VEGF-A and PDGF. It forms a depot on intravitreal injection into the inferior vitreous, which gradually releases the drug for up to a period of 6 months. The Adagio phase 1-2 trial showed that 88% of the patients maintained on a single dose of injection for about 3 months, and 68% did not need an injection for another 6 months. So PAN90806 is a topical tyrosine kinase inhibitor by Panoptica. So in the phase 1-2 trial, they gave topical drops and offered rescue injections from week 2. In the trial, they could avoid about 79% of possible rescue injections. There was no control group for this study. And coming to other molecular targets that are being looked at, this particular molecule, Icon-1, targets the tissue factor. And in the eMERGE trial, they found that it causes, in combination with ranibizumab, there is more reduction in the size of the CNVM, but visual outcome was similar in both groups. Then AKST-429 by Alkahest is another molecule targeting this chemokine called eotaxin. So in the phase 2 study, on CNV refractory to antibiogen, this is important, in refractory CNVM, this drug could cause a gain of around 2 letters in the mean, and about 8% of the patients gain 10 letters or more. This is an oral drug. Coming to carotuximab by Santen Pharmaceuticals Japan, this is an antibody against endoglin, and this also is targeting refractory CNVMs. So in 4 mg dose cohort, it was found to have around 3.3 letter gain at 90 days. So coming to newer routes and drug delivery systems, we have the ranibizumab port delivery system manufactured by Genentech. This is a transscleral pars-planar device refillable implant. It requires surgery for implantation, and the refill can be done later in the OPD. So in the ladder trial, phase 2 trial, in the 100 mg per ml cohort showed visual outcomes similar to monthly injections of ranibizumab. And 80% of the patients did not require any refill for 6 months, and 60% could maintain without refill for about 12 months. Vitreous hemorrhage was there initially in 50% of the patients, which could be brought down to 4.5% after the modification of the procedure. Another interesting route of administration is a suprachoroidal injector. Clearside Biomedical has come out with a proprietary micro-injector which delivers the drug into the suprachoroidal space. In PhD trial, they used this injector to administer triamcinolone in uveitic CME. They found that the visual outcomes were improved compared to control group, and IOP rise in cataract was comparable to control group, as in there is no increase in IOP and cataract. Coming to drugs for dry AMD, we have this elamipetride by Stealth Biotherapeutics. It's a mitochondrial protective drug which reduces reactive oxygen species and decreases oxidative stress. It is delivered by subcutaneous injection. Reclaim trial looked at this drug and found that it improved visual acuity and dark adaptation in dry AMD. Another drug is your risatiganib, manufactured by Allegro. It regulates endocrine function. It is an intravitreal medication. Phase 2 trial showed 8 letter gain in 48% of the patients versus 7% in sham injection group. Another drug is your pegcetacoplan, manufactured by Apellis. It's a complement 3 cleavage inhibitor. Intravitreal injections prevented geographical atrophy progression by around 20 to 29%. Avacincaptad pegol, Zemura, is manufactured by Everic Bio. Mechanism of action is C5 inhibition. It also prevented geographical atrophy progression by 20 to 27%. Primonidine implant was manufactured by Allergan. It also acts by cytoprotective action on the RPE and Müller cells. It is an intravitreal medication similar to Ozurdex, a sustained release implant. It also prevented geographical atrophy growth by 19 to 28%. The last drug is your GR39821, which is an anti-HTRA1 antibody. It's a protease expressed in RPE degrading extracellular matrix. In the trials, phase 1 trials, safety has been established. Efficacy trials are still ongoing. Coming to a conclusion, this newer treatments for these diseases can reduce the follow-up burden of these chronic retinal diseases and improve visual outcomes. It can also help a subset of patients in whom nothing works. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Dilesh, for that wonderful talk. Our next speaker is Dr. Remya. She is a VR consultant at Little Flower Hospital, Angamali. She'll be talking about newer laser techniques.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Dr. Remya. I work as a consultant with a retina surgeon at Little Flower Hospital, Angamali. It's an honor, and I thank Dr. Divya for this opportunity. The first device in the evolution of laser is MESER, which used amplified microwaves. It was invented by Charles Hartounes. During the same period, Mahesh Vikarath, the father of modern retinal photocoagulation, was experimenting with an optical method to coagulate the retina. He collaborated with Zeiss Laboratories to develop the xenon arc lamp photocoagulation. Dr. Shrikanath's ideas combined with the advances in laser opened the doors for various options using a laser light source to photocoagulate the retina. With the technological development, the mechanical reaction on the retina has also improved. This mechanical theory of the most interest today is the non-damaging laser treatment method that promotes retinal rejuvenation with less tissue disruption. Let us learn about the new lasers with case examples. This is a 25-year-old male who presented with defective vision of 2 weeks duration. It's a typical case of central serous retinopathy with subretinal fluid. He was managed conservatively for 3 months. Even after that, he did not resolve with regard to subretinal fluid or with the visual acuity. Hence, he was subjected to fluorescein angiography, which revealed a well-defined subfoveal leak at the fovea, which is an inglot kind of pattern. At this point, the options that were considered was focal laser, but it was not done due to the damage of scarring, greater collateral damage. And when done at the foveal area, it can cause photoreceptor loss and deterioration in vision. PDT was not opted for because it was an expensive method which the patient could not afford. Injection of metoprolol dye is required and post laser regimen is very strict and cumbersome. So micropulse laser, let's make a decision on which laser to be used. Let's see the pros and cons of micropulse laser. This is a laser which uses a continuous wave laser beam that is chopped into short repetitive microsecond pulses. Laser on time is the duration of each micropulse and the off time is the time between the micropulses. Ratio between the on time and off time is known as a duty cycle. Eyes treated with micropulse laser do not exhibit damage to the photoreceptors and thus it does not produce much pigmentary changes, avoiding scotoma, color vision loss and loss of contrast sensitivity. Due to the safety of micropulse, it can be repeated without limit. So this patient was subjected to micropulse laser in left eye with 5% duty cycle, spot site of 100 microns, and this is how he responded with complete resolution of subretinal fluid. The second case is a 52-year-old male with defective vision of the right eye of 1 year duration. The best corrected visual acuity at presentation was 6x60 and 10. The fluorescein angiography as well as OCT was characteristic of a chronic CSCR. Micropulse laser in a grid pattern was applied in the area of the area of sick RP, both in the macular area as well as supratemporally. And this is how he responded with a complete or near total resolution of the sky-to cavity and more remodeling of the retina in a better way. So micropulse laser is known to reduce inflammation and it evokes elimination of fluid due to RP stimulation by production of cytokines and boosting pump activity of the retinal pigment epithelium. There are two different modalities of this laser technique. One is the LO laser and the 810 nanometer. 577 nanometer produces a more targeted burn with less laser spot expansion. There also seems to be an advantage of less luteal pigment absorption and potentially less risk when treating closer to the fovea. From the treatment standpoint, the 577 nanometer wavelength may produce a deeper burn, allowing it to go below the level of the retinal pigment epithelium to effectively treat choroidal-based pathologies, including central serous retinopathy. It can also be used in cases of diabetic macular edema, wherein, according to the fluorescein angiography, these points of diffuse leakage can be marked, and this micropulse laser can be delivered in a grid pattern. Nevertheless, a navigated laser is a unique platform that combines color, infrared, and fluorescein fundus imaging to produce the most precise laser treatment. Fluorescein images as well as OCT images can be overlaid correctly to identify the leakage points and target the appropriate lesion adequately while minimizing damage to the healthy tissue. Eye tracking software also is incorporated, which allows precision of laser treatment. Navilas also produces a full documentation of each laser spot applied, thus ensuring for the first time true traceability and enabling potential retreatment. With pre-planned laser positions and automatic execution of laser spots, it can ensure the correct tissue is activated and remodeled. Let us move on from CSR and diabetic macular edema to proliferative diabetic retinopathy. This is a clear-cut case of proliferative diabetic retinopathy, which now we have an option of Pascal laser. The Pascal photocoagulator delivers multiple burns in a rapid predetermined sequence in the form of a pattern of array. These are the various patterns which are available, and this is given in a pulse duration which is reduced to 10 to 30 milliseconds. The aim is to minimize the side effects with optimizing the therapeutic effect. Post laser shows localized pigmented scar burns that have minimum laser expansion, and it has also an advantage that it, although it overlaps the venules and arterioles, with no signs of direct damage to the retinal blood vessels from the treatment array. To conclude, conventional laser photocoagulation has been proven to be an effective means to treat ocular diseases. However, it results in full thickness damage to the RPE and choroid. Subthreshold laser therapy aims to limit the potential side effects that can develop while still allowing the therapeutic effect. This could therefore be a great advantage when treating lesions very close to the fovea. The main drawback with the micropulse subthreshold laser is the absence of a visible endpoint and constant worry of undertreatment. The ultimate solution, however, should come from a technique that can provide in real time the intraoperative monitoring of a pseudo endpoint with recording of the locations where such endpoints can be achieved. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Remya, for that excellent talk. Now, let me introduce our keynote speaker, Dr. Rajini Bhattu. She is a senior consultant in Department of Ophthalmology at Aster CMI Hospital, Bangalore. Following her master's in ophthalmology from St. John's Medical College, Bangalore, she obtained her fellowship from Royal College of Surgeons, Edinburgh, fellowship training in VR surgery from Shankar Netralaya, Chennai, fellowship in inherited retinal diseases from Moorfields Eye Hospital, London. She was awarded a PhD from Maastricht University, Netherlands, for her work on inherited retinal diseases. She was awarded the best paper at Karnataka Ophthalmic Society in 2014 and the prestigious J.M. Power Award for Best Paper at the National VRSA meeting in 2019. She is the co-founder of iSTEM, a company dedicated to retinal stem cell research, and founder of Center for Eye Genetics and Research, Bangalore, dedicated to patients with retinal degenerative disease. She is also an adjunct faculty at Institute of Bioinformatics and Applied Biotechnology, Bangalore. Welcome, ma'am, to deliver her keynote address. She'll be talking about newer treatments in retina, gene therapy, and stem cell therapy.
Hello, everyone. I'm Dr. Rajini Bhattu. I'm very grateful, Dr. Divya, and KSOS for this wonderful opportunity. So my topic is going to be on the latest in retinal treatment, stem cell therapy and gene therapy. Allow me to share my slides. So retinal degenerations like dry AMD and retinal dystrophies cause progressive vision loss and have no treatment as we speak. The burden of both these conditions is quite a bit. AMD accounts for nearly 10% of all blindness worldwide, especially over the age of 60. And in India, about 1.5 to 4 crore people are estimated to suffer from AMD. RP, of course, is a lot more prevalent compared to a prevalence of 1 in 3,500 in the US. Over 1 in 1,000 patients have RP in India. That translates to over a million patients with retinitis pigmentosa alone. There are nearly 300 genes that have been mapped to cause retinal dystrophies. While the association of genetics in AMD is not as strong as with retinal dystrophies, we do have significant predisposing genes. Currently, therapy is not much. Apart from ARIDS in dry AMD, only diseases like RHEFSMs and gyrate atrophy have some form of therapy. So what treatment options do we have? So when we're looking at mutation-specific treatments, we look at gene therapy, whereas mutation-independent approaches would be cell replacement therapy, retinal processes, and so on. We're going to look at the former two in this gene therapy. Why the eye specifically for gene therapy? There are specific advantages. The transparency of the ocular media that allows us to deliver the vectors directly to the area of interest. The ability to do high-resolution imaging is a very important aspect. Of course, the eye is a contained tissue, and therefore dissemination of what we inject into the eye is not much. Relatively immune privileged, we could use the other eye as a control, and we have a wide range of animal models to use for experiments. some basic principles of gene therapy. So the majority of the genes that cause retinitis pigmentosa cause encode proteins that are either in the retinal pigment epithelium or the photoreceptor inner or outer segments. Now, gene therapy involves two aspects. One is the gene replacement or gene silencing. In autosomal recessive diseases, there are two copies of the defective mutation, and therefore the protein that is formed is nearly non-functional. Therefore, it suffices just to replace the defective copy of the gene with the correct copy. So we have gene replacement therapy. Whereas in autosomal dominant diseases, where we have a single copy, it is actually forming a protein that can be quite detrimental to the functioning of the retina. And therefore, we need to silence that and then replace the defective gene. Irrespective of what approach, vectors play the key role. Most of us, most gene therapy trials use viral vectors. The commonest that is used is the adenoviral vector, very suited for use in the eye. The biggest limitation is its limited ability to carry genes of larger nature. Therefore, diseases like Stargardt, Usher's, and so on, which have a larger gene, are not suitable to be carried by AAV. So lentivirus is an alternative, has its own drawbacks, like a potential mutation that can occur at the point of insertion. And therefore, there are several non-viral vectors that are also being tried. Of course, the different modes of delivery, the intravitreal delivery and the subretinal delivery. Intravitreal is something that's very easy for us to use, reaches the entire retinal surface, although the effect is limited because it is not reaching the RP and the photoreceptors. The immune reactions are also higher. Whereas with subretinal delivery, although the procedure itself is a lot more complex, it comes in direct contact with the pigment epithelium and the photoreceptor. So December 2017 was a landmark time when the US FDA approved gene therapy for RPE65 associated LCA. This causes both LCA and early onset retinitis pigmentosa. This is one of my patients with a very typical RPE65 associated LCA, and that's her report, which shows a homozygous mutation in RPE65. So the phase 3 trial, apart from the inclusion factors of the best correct vision and so on, one of the requirements was their ability to perform MLMT or the multi-luminance mobility test. Remember, these children had such poor vision that they could not be tested either on Stellens or ATDRS, and therefore a very specific mobility test was created called the multi-luminance mobility test. And the injection was done through a 41 gauge needle, a routine 25 or 27 gauge pass plenar vitrectomy, followed by an injection into the subretinal space. So MLMT was a very useful mobility course that was used apart from all other endpoints. That's one of the classic tests that is used in these situations. So following the injection a year after the treatment, the results were quite modest, although there was an improvement. And post US FDA approval, it's now approved for several countries in Europe, although it is not yet approved in India. Cost is the biggest prohibitive factor. It is priced close to $500,000 per injection per eye. There are several other genes that are being considered for therapy. The list is quite exhaustive. There are quite a few challenges. Whether a one-time administration of the vector is sufficient, can it provide long-term benefits? What about those where it cannot be carried on the adeno-associated virus? The biggest challenge, of course, is the cost and the fact that it is only limited to those patients with a very specific mutation. It cannot be a blanket therapy. So that's where stem cells come in. So stem cells involve administration of cells, either that are procured by embryonic stem cells or induced pluripotent stem cells. And iPSC was first started by Professor Yamanaka, for which he got the Nobel. So we formed a company about 4 years ago called iStem. Our main work is in retinal stem cells. And this is one of our studies that I'm going to show you, where we worked on the retinal pigment epithelium. And what we did was to obtain peripheral blood and convert them to PBMC or mononuclear cells. From there, the cells go through a process where they eventually follow what happens in vivo and form mature hexagonal retinal pigment epithelium. So these are some of the markers that are used. These are in immunohistochemistry markers that show us that the cells that we are using are indeed retinal pigment epithelium, and that they are functional and they are nearly mature and they are a pure population. Okay, so this is how it is seen on an Eppendorf tube, a small tube that has about 2 ml in suspension, and that 2 ml is actually sufficient to treat about 20 patients. So the next step was to implant it in the animal model, which was the RCS rat, which is a good model both for AMD and retinitis pigmentosa. Carries a mutation in the gene called the MERTK gene, which causes damage to the RPE and therefore loss of photoreceptors also. So we had 16 animals in our initial study. In 8 animals, we use a lower dose of 50,000 cells per eye, whereas the other group had the higher dose of 100,000 cells per eye. We use the left eye for the cells and the right eye as the control. And this is how the subretinal transplantation is done in these animals. It's a blind procedure, unlike what we do in the human eye. And optokinetic thresholds were used to assess vision apart from histology. So we had a successful bleb formation and delivery of cells in all animals. One animal did not require from anesthesia. These were the optokinetic tracking thresholds. So this is on day 60, and this is at day 90. So if you see, these are the vehicles and these are the low and the high dose. There is not much difference at 60, whereas at 90, well, the normal animals without the injection continue to lose vision, there is a significant visual sustained in animals that had the injection. These are the histological data. So one of the surrogate markers that we use are these outer nuclear layer. Look at it where the outer nuclear layer in the cell in the saline injected eye is quite a degenerated, while that's a very healthy outer nuclear layer in eyes that had the cells. So those are at 60 and 90. At 90, obviously, the results are a lot more striking. And we also looked at the cone quantification, the retinal thickness, and so on. So we did notice inflammation in 3 out of 30 animals. Remember, these are immunosuppressed rats. We had given them cyclosporin to begin with. So to conclude, we did have a significant rescue of vision in these animals up to 70 days post-transplantation, and we did not have any significant safety concerns, including tumor formation. There are several limitations. The rodent model itself has no macula, and when we're looking at AMD, a complex disease, that is probably not the most ideal. The injection itself is a blind procedure, and we are doing a xenograft, that means injecting human cells into an animal eye. So apart from this, there are several challenges in this field itself, whether we should use RP suspension, should we use a sheet, what about the immune reaction, how easy is this to inject them. There are a few groups that are working on this. Professor Masayo Takahashi in Japan is actually running a trial in both with sheets and suspension. And one of the most advanced is this company called CellCure or Lineage Therapeutics. This is their details from ARVO 2020, which was a virtual meeting. This is how they injected. They have a very elegant way of injecting these cells subretinally. They do it through the suprachoroidal space, and they access it under the retina and inject it. So this is their results. This is at baseline, and see at 1 year follow-up how the entire drusen have significantly flattened. So what's the roadmap for our own company? We have had some difficulties with the pandemic like most people. However, our roadmap to start our clinical trials have proceeded unhindered. We now have a collaboration with Elvi Prasada Institute to start our phase 1 trials, which we're hoping should start probably in the second or third quarter of 2021. We finished a pre-IND meeting with the US FDA a year ago. We're also working on the photoreceptors, which is just about a year behind the RP schedule. We have an IP for the process of making these. So in summary, in spite of the multiple challenges that seem to present to us, both gene therapy and stem cell therapy represent a giant leap in the treatment of patients who till now have no treatment. And I do think that these are indeed very exciting times ahead. So that is my team. We've had several collaborations across the world. Thank you very much for a very, very patient hearing. Much obliged.
Thank you, ma'am, for that wonderful and informative talk.